Welcome back, y'all, to part two of Memories Don't Die. We covered the first six tracks, the last part. Pretty dope. The only really gripe I had about it was Shooters, track number two. You know, felt like it could have been better produced by C-Sick. But with that being said, though, it was definitely a solid set that I got to chant, you know, pretty much vibe out with y'all. And today we're going to cover the next set of six, basically the second period, and knock out these final six tracks. But I will say the third set is going to be a little longer, so I'll see if I can actually cheat and do an extra track on this second part. If not, oh well. Anyway, six is the goal. That's what I'm going to do for y'all. So with all that said and being done, let's pick up where we last left off on track number seven, titled Real Thing featuring Future.
Bought that ass for me on a jet ski. She said I might even lick it if you let me. You know I would kill the pussy when you met me. And the swine in the mind can regret me.
Looking at my ass.
to have it. Track number 7, Real Thing, featuring Future. Comes in clean, sharp, hits hard like a motherfucking trap 808 beat with him. I mean, this is a typical CSIC 808 that comes in and just clean sweeps the whole joint, you know. And that 808 bounce is just contagious. I mean, damn. This is what makes the new Toronto hot, like the series in general. CSIC only did one track, I believe, on the first one, which was the last track of the song. Personally, my favorite song of that mixtape. Don't get me wrong, Play Picasso's fire when he produced beats. The dude goes in like trap hard. I don't think anyone can really touch him when it comes to that murky shit. but with that being said, Play Picasso and CSIC just go well together, man. They bounce off each other so damn well. You know what I mean? Like Kobe and Shaq, essentially. Like, these two are just phenomenal with how they do things, you know? Play Picasso be like that Shaq, just straight up dominating you with his beats. And then, you know, CSIC's a little bit finesse with his shit. You know, like Kobe gonna hit you everywhere and score whatever, how you gotta do it. But you know what I mean? Like, it's just, they both dominate. And when they work together, I mean, you're talking about a dynasty. And you add in Tory Lanez to the mix, who really is just gonna be like the ultimate X factor if a song makes or breaks. I mean, you can't just have anybody come on one of their joints and just, you know, do their thing. I mean, it takes someone special, and Tory's got that, you know. So this ain't no overshadowing who Tory is. It's just more of shining the limelight on the people that's backing Tory up. Like, this is a phenomenal team that Tory's got built, and the song just perfectly executes that idea, in my opinion. But with that being said, Future killed it on the feature, came in, did his thing, you know what I mean? It's just two of the toughest trap stars right here on a joint together, and I think that's, you know, well apportioned, in my opinion. Like, it's been a long time waiting to see these two collab, and yeah, they finally did it. I think I've been waiting on this shit since like 2014, to be honest with y'all, so fuck it. But we're gonna go ahead and move on to the next track, track number 8. This one's titled Hate to Say, so let's get it.
Apartment far from the budget. I remember us living not too far from the junkies, the flunkies that tried to punk me on corners but never sung me, I swear. And this bitch, yeah, I'm killing this year. The boys say that they gon' feel it this year. I bought a Rari, I only drove it in once. I'm moving different this year. I'm leaving thousands, talking millions this year. When niggas really talking, talk it over, renegotiated, made the plan, and cough it over. I crossed over like Iverson when he dropped the shoulder on Jordan. The feeling more than the sport when you win it. Fuck how they feeling, the feelings got left aside. I told him to step aside. I'm really eating, I'm ordering extra size, you know me. Round the block glow for spitting them high flows. My scent smell like Michelle was touching Barack's clothes. Presidential, the flow is so evidential. Like the clear poor customs, I barely show my credentials. Don't need a tenant, I want you to know who's in it. Had me offended last time that I walked in the whole rent room. Let's break it down for him. Account this, if every show's 100 down for him, then that mean 100 minutes on stage would equal 100K. That's 1,000 a minute, so please don't get offended if I walk inside a store and spend 35 in it. Cause to me, that's just 35 minutes. Land in Jamaica, sip on a Guinness and get it. Who wanna witness my nigga? I'm really sick with the shiznit. I brought Big Poppy out at the Sunfest. Sean Kingston watched it from the side stage. I made Triple E advance that he had gave me in my first year. 45 minutes of me on stage. And I'm not amazed. I think the tape's turning. I think you learn from the bridge you burn when you see it burning. I think you learn from the world when you see it turning. I went from being a server to being this platinum deserver, you feel me? Did a song with Meek Melly, called it Litty. Really, I just did that shit for the city. In love with Philly, got this chinchilla fur on me just in case it gets chilly. Burn it on my side pocket, that's just in case you get illy out here. Me and Travis Scott almost fought at the Malaluna. We both agreed shortly after that it was music we possibly could be doing that's bigger than trying to ruin it. So my apologies, nigga, just forgive me for doing it. History made in New York City, we called a truce at the tower. I only brought a couple niggas with me. The beef was finished as soon as we took the picture. The world was watching attention. The industry started shifting to me. Lord forgive him, Lord forgive him. I was tripping all the time. I spent subliminal dissing just trying to rip shit.
Not realizing if I took the time to kick it in me and Drake, man, the bridges and probably equal to winning. Got the hard head.
Nah, I'm not. Right there, I gotta pause it because I don't think, and I still believe Drake doesn't give a shit about Tory winning. Not one fucking bit. So, I salute Tory for being a good Samaritan right here, having that positive mindset, but I don't think Drake's about that life, straight up. And I think he should still stay away from that nigga. Because right now, that nigga only is concerned with his own sake. I mean, he's already in hot water right now. I'm not going to mention what it is. I don't give a fuck. Honestly, that's his life. But with that being said, though, I don't think Tory should be fucking with Drake, personally. It's his life. He can choose whatever he does, but that's just... If he was to come to ask me, that's what I would say. I say, I don't think you should be fucking with Drake. That dude doesn't really care about no one more than he does care about himself. Simple as that. He does care about people, help him out, but at the end of the day, about building people, especially when it comes to people he feels he's afraid of that is going to be better than him. He's got that, I'm not saying that he's not generous or anything. I'm just saying, like, he's very egomatistic, and I don't think he's going to welcome someone who's more talented. Or, you know, he just has a lot of jealousy in that, I feel like, when it comes to seeing people more talented. So honestly, no, I don't think he's going to fuck with Tory the right way that I would, that everyone honestly would probably wish for, man. Because at the end of the day, who wouldn't want to see Drake, The Weeknd, and Tory all together on a song? I mean, they're essentially the big three of Toronto. But yeah, I don't think that's going to work, man. Drake really has to be, it has to be respectful and, you know, come to you on that humble shit if he's gonna fucks with you, man. Because, like, how is he gonna say that, you know, he's cool with you manning things when he hasn't even come in the studio and make a song with you yet? Like, and I know you've already made songs with, you're not afraid to make songs with anybody. That much is shown and proven, so I respect that. But at the same time, how the fuck is he still not gonna make a fucking song, bro? What the fuck are you doing, man? Fucking make a turn signal, you stupid ass motherfucker. Anyways, my point is, because of that, nah, I wouldn't really still trust that nigga. Like, yeah, they say keep your enemies close to you, but there's also a time and moment when you shouldn't really be opening up with them as well either. I mean, especially when you see what he was doing with them subtle tweets and shot, like, Tory didn't even recognize that. He thought it was just like all brothers, you know, brotherly love and all that, but Drake don't give a fuck. Like the Instagram trying to make him look like a fool, and then the videos too of him trying to cross him over in the basketball video. And what sucks too is that Tory subconsciously reciprocated that effect on YK Orisis. Like, I've seen this shit, it's bad, you know. And it's not on Tory more as it is on Drake for being a bad role model and a big brother essentially to Tory, because I know that's how he looks to Drake up as. But Drake don't see that. Drake sees Tory as someone who's better than him, who's going to eventually, you know, overtop him as, you know, the most popular and pretty much the greatest artist coming out of Toronto, and he don't want that. So I just sense all jealousy and envy coming from Drake's side. Hey, it's just the vibe I'm feeling. I could just see it, you know, break it down. I mean, I don't really need to be there with them to know that. I could just sense it, man. It's crazy. But let me say this though. If anything, I pray to God that I'm wrong and that this is not true and this is not happening behind the scenes, you know, from where publicity don't see that shit. But I really do feel that way. Drake don't want to see Tory win, as simple as that. So he'll do whatever he can, even if it means that he has to mend things and actually go on tour with him to make it look like he's best buddies with Tory, so that way Tory can let his guard down. Because let me tell you something, all right? When Tory's guard down and when he's relaxed, that's when he's the most vulnerable, and that's when really you can get after him. But when this nigga is on all four, 10 toes in, nobody can touch him. And that's what Drake's afraid of, man. Straight up. Straight fucking up. Don't fuck with Tory, because he will come and bust your ass. I'm speaking as an artist, man. Like, the dude just is so tapped in. He really has the gift to be and tools to really be the best artist in the world. And I'm talking about, like, greatest, man. Really can. I think he can be better than Michael Jackson. I said it. He's got the team. He's got the crew to do it. And really, he has the blueprint, the recipe to commit to it. So far, he hasn't really, in 2019, shown that much. I could understand now why. I mean, I still think that it was the wrong decision to go with. I still feel like, regardless of what others are doing, plotting and trying to copy his style, he should still keep doing him instead of just holding back to see if it would die or not. But I get why he held back and not put out any like of his OG content for 2 years, because he don't want niggas snatching his shit. But I still disagree with that. Like, he should still put it out in spite of that. Be like, okay, keep trying to copy me, but I'm still gonna do me better than you can. You know what I mean? Go boasting on them niggas. Don't be afraid. That's how you fucking got here in the first place. You was never afraid to be yourself. So I say keep doing it. With that being said, god damn, I made that too long. He's gonna bring up a certain line that I'm pretty sure everyone has heard of when he dissed Eric Bellinger. I'm gonna let him finish that real quick, then after that I'm gonna skip the song, because I think it's just, I really like this song for the fact that he really puts everything out there. He puts about Travis, he talks about Drake, even though, like I said, don't buy into that shit. Don't even try to fake love that shit. Don't, just still say fuck that nigga. And most person, or like most important thing of all, like, he called out Eric Bellinger on some true shit. And trust me, if it wasn't true, Eric Bellinger wouldn't have gotten in his feelings and made that yikes diss record. Trust me, he would have just let that shit hit. That's all I'm gonna say. With that being said, let me play this final part.
Money coming so thick, the niggas call it hard bread dough. I'm in this all red foe, see that I'm leaning like the old six foes. I said I stopped freestyling, but fuck it, oh well, a nigga flow so well, I'm like a sampling kit. Give a fuck about who get pissed about my samples and skits. Niggas mad, I'm remixing they shit. Fuck out of here, nigga, stop being a bitch. Niggas tell me cut the silence by niggas that's talking violence.
There we go.
Speak of silence and give them coffins and violence plan. Beat niggas with Cisco haircuts, wildin' and stylin' and dissin'. Guess they just tryna go viral, I feel them. This your favorite song, this gon' be your favorite song. Said what I'm saying, it's really the people's favorite song. You did a bit dissin'.
Wait, you said he did a fake diss?
Flex, I ain't. I could've flexed a Rari and Rafe, but nigga, I ain't.
Oh, shit. It almost sounds like as if Tory was gonna predict what Eric Bellinger was gonna write the song about. You know what? I think they might have had some confrontation before they made the record. And let me see if I can make a left real quick, y'all. Be patient with me. I really want to keep continuing this. Yes, thank you. So like I was trying to say, damn man, I mean, if they had some kind of confrontation before Eric Bellinger made that record, and Tory picked up right from then and there what he knew what he was gonna say. Like, what Eric was going to say about him in a diss record and mention it here, that is fire. Because that's exactly what Eric Bellinger did mention. It's like Tory knew, because, like, look, I don't think anyone has to tell Tory, or, I mean, like, don't tell me, because I can obviously tell how woke this dude is, but it's just phenomenal. This nigga is ridiculously mad genius. That's what I like about this dude. He's fucking mad genius. He knows the things that people will say to diss about him. And because of that, he's gonna say, I know you're gonna say this about me. So, like, I'm just saying, you know, I could flex on you with the car if I wanted to, but I'm not. That's mad genius. I think that's probably the most over-the-head shit he just said on this whole fucking song. Wow. It took me... when did this drop? March 2018. I don't think anyone, not, I've seen several YouTubers cover this album. I don't think anyone has mentioned that fact. I don't think, because anyone was, I don't think anyone that listened to this album and did a YouTube cover was as deep in listening to Eric Bellinger as they was probably was to Tory and really get a fact of who they both are. But yo, that's some crazy insider shit I just gave y'all. Like, Tory's a fucking mad genius. He knows what his weaknesses are. He's not stupid. And he knows that's the same shit niggas are gonna pull up on him. And because of that, he's gonna fucking mention it in a song before you even drop a diss record. Like, I know you're gonna make a diss record and this is what you're gonna say, but I'm letting you know it's right. It's okay. Like, I could flex on you if I wanted to, but I'm not. That's fucking mad genius. Fucking mad. Smart, man. Shit. Yo, I'm not saying that's entirely true. This is just purely hypothetical thinking. But if this is what really how Tory takes it, my bad for spilling your beans and juice and inside shit, but that's fucking mad smart. Wow. Look, I don't give a fuck if you can't figure out sine and cosine or trigonometry or even like calculus. I don't care if you... Look, you don't have to be rocket scientist. If you can be socially aware, woke, smart, and know how to play with people's minds, that's like creative mentality right there. Like, it takes a lot of mind focus and really to be able to... Like, not many people can have that mindset. I'm one of them, but I think this is really why it fucks with Tory. Like, his mentality is so similar to fucking mine. It's downright scary. Like, I could probably talk to this nigga and then, like, for 30 seconds straight, we both say the same shit that comes out of a fucking mind. Who knows? I don't even know. I don't care. My point is, that's sick as fuck if that's what he meant. If he was predicting what Eric Bellinger was gonna say about him in Yikes, which was pretty generic. It was like anyone could have said the same shit about Tory, but predicting that he was gonna do that and saying that, yeah, I could flex, I mean, that's just crazy cold. That's all I'm gonna say. With that being said, I'm not gonna hold too back on this song. Let me get to track number 9, BID. This is essentially the blueprint for what his next album will follow after. Don't get me wrong, I do that same shit too when I'm super high. Alright, cool. I do that all the fucking time. With that relatable piece out the way though, this song is hot. It's definitely fire. Just cold, man. I mean, perfect for the summer theme, you know, but what I don't like is that he does kind of try to model after this song. Love Me Now, I'm not gonna get too much deep into it, but in an entirely different fashion than how he did this song. It just feels like Tory really trying one of these joints, you know, like taking that beat and really being yourself. Like, it really feels like Tory's being himself on this, and I love it. It's just him going in, bust it down, bust it down, bust it down. Oh yeah, yeah, yeah. Like just clean as fuck when he does it. With that being said, yeah, I love BID. I just call it BID, but it is Busted Down. I love the acronym and how it just sounds. It sounds so bold and like ballistic, you know what I mean? So with that being said, track number 10, 48 Floors, coming up, featuring Mansa.
I can't make no dinner but a nigga with the breakfast. We can smoke, we can fall, what's your preference? Wrote to Santa just to put you on my sex list. Shook out the $1 million on out to Craigslist. Oh yeah, you know who I am. All these bitches in the crib, bitches go to the test. Ain't no maybe not the bag, but I go to the sky. We can go to Miami, girl, we can go to Santa. That's where I'm going, open up the radios, oh yeah. You know, make me wait for it. Pussy so good, I should have to pay for it, oh yeah. 48 floors, that's where I'm going, open up the radios, oh yeah. You know, make me wait for it. Pussy so good, I should have to pay for it.
The second half, it's cool. Mansa comes in, he's pretty chill, it's laid back, it's nice. If he was trying to do kind of like high tempo slash a low tempo mix into this song in one whole track, I really liked the first part so much, I felt like that should have been the whole song, like that should have been everything. I think Mansa could have maybe tackled that. It's just kind of a little weird because he sounds so similar to Tory Lanez. When I first listened to this, I really thought it was Tory trying a different voice module or something. And I realized, oh, it's Mansa, like a different artist. I searched him, like, because I didn't want to get confused like how I did one time when he did Rory True Story. And I'm like, that definitely has to be Tory Lanez, just an alter ego. But yeah, it ended up being against someone else too. So, and Mansa definitely is his own human being. It's just crazy because, fuck, like I don't hate Mansa's part. It's dope as fuck. But I really wanted that first part to be extended more, man. Like I needed more of that. It was just so lit. And I think if Tory would have done that, 48 Floors, and made that the whole 3 minutes 38 seconds, release it as a single, I think he would have had a top 10 hit here. Because it just sucks. Like, it shouldn't just be on Spotify as part of the album and have people just listen to it because they wanted to check out the album. I feel like that should have been that headliner for this album. I mean, 48 Floors is just so hot. It definitely is a Category A song, in my opinion. And damn, bro. Like, that's another song where I'm like, you had the chance to capitalize, but you didn't. I mean, it just didn't fall through, man. Same thing. It's the same thing how I feel about Shooters, man. I feel like it wasn't complete yet. It wasn't ready to be put out yet. Like, you should have stayed on it, let it left in the vault, work on it a little more, extend it the whole 3 minutes and 38 seconds instead of having Mansa's part. I mean, because I think that could have been a dope-ass interlude. Like, let Mansa have his own interlude. Let that be a song in itself. You know, let it be a different title song. Shoot, who cares? It could be titled Mansa's Interlude and follow after this. But 48 Floors in itself should have been the first part with Tory, the first beat I'm talking about. Continuing the whole 3 minutes and 38. Maybe you could have Mansa be on a feature, who knows? Or someone else, like Trey Songz. Or it could just be Tory giving you another verse. I just feel like the first part of 48 Floors should be extended. You know, definitely. Too hot of a joint. With that being said, let's do track number 11. It's going to be titled BBW/Fake Show. And then we'll go from there.
Yeah. Bought a new white Wraith. Last night got it crashed. Spinning out on the highway. 720 in the ass. Bad bitch in the passage. Seen a whole life flashing. Ray whipping the McLaren right behind me. Niggas spun right past me. Thank God I'm alive. Thank God, but I probably gotta spend a bank job on a ride. Back bubble white Wraith. Cost 19K. But that ain't none of my safe. All you rappers ain't safe. Let me say it with the bass. All you rappers ain't safe. All you singers ain't safe. First single had me in the crib. Putting platinum plaques in the place. Drop love, went top, pop club. Everything just grace. Grammy nominated on the first album. Motherfuckers see the face. Look at me. I know these niggas is tripping. These niggas is shook of me. Bust down. Raffaello, what you did to me? I need the money at last. I need the money at fast. Tell me the money is near. I ain't coming out of fast. Keep close, gotta keep hoes by the G-code. Got 3 holes in the G-fold. Got A, B, C, D, F, G, X, Y, and Z hoes. I'm still ballin' like D-Rose. I'm still poppin' on V-Rose. I'm still looking like Ray. Still sippin' on C-Souls. My dick giant like FIFO. If you need no money singin' in a C-Dome like Do-Ray, B, Faso, Latino. Get it for my niggas back home. In a fee house selling crack on a trap phone in the crack home. When it's time getting cold, had to go to Bramble Leafs, fill a jacket up about a Jack Jones. Rogers had me get mad at the phone bill, switching to the black phone. Yeah, I had to switch to a Telus. Ain't really shit you can tell us. All of y'all niggas is jealous. Running through the check, money upset. All of these niggas is mad at me. 10 chains, by 10 rings on a nigga looking like swag that me. I can't keep a girlfriend, too busy trying to make the bag happen. Cali girl throw back at me in the back alley in the cat daddy. Yeah, I say bust down. I throw dick at your bitch. She gon' touchdown. Bitch, I'm up now, what now? Fuck about what you saw about. That shit sound like us now. My shit sound like what now?
Tory Lanez, you need to hit me up. I just got the perfect song that you need to include in New Toronto 3. That's all I'm gonna tell you. Hit me up, brother. Woo! I just got a great idea. That's all I'm gonna say. Continue on.
Come with these different dangers. You rather lie to me, tell me you still an angel.
How you still an angel? You be lying, you just fuck some niggas on me and claim you see it from different angles. I see the danger. I find it crazy shit. I know you as a good girl. Tip a slow tripper, turn stripper. Last night, call a hot sex off liquor. Trash bag full of every dollar at the bar that you kneeling down to pick up for these niggas throwing it up. You hate it when niggas getting dirty what they want, so hate the reason why you bout to get them Louis Vuitton, so hate the reason why you bout to get your rent paid. Tell them hoes throwing shade, they should wear they best shades. She gon' make a thousand on a bad day. 10 hours shipping, she'll never take a half day. Told me dancing was a pathway and did it to the fullest, cause she hated leaving halfway. Hold up, bust it, I can't trust it. Fucking with you got me going way up out of budget. Pour a shot up, this is for the last night. Last night before I lost it to the fast life.
There you go. Damn, I wish I had enough space to do one more song. I only got like 2 more minutes before it cuts me off. And this track, the next track coming up, I cannot do that. I'm sorry, y'all. Apologize, maybe it was too much talking, I screwed up. But we will go ahead and continue off on part 3 with track number 12. And I'll see you there. But hey, before I let y'all go, the second set right here is clean as F-U-C-K. That's all I'm gonna say. I don't wanna swear too much. But that was clean, sharp, smooth. Each track really had a different variety, and I feel like the middle of the pack really has some strong residue in it. You know what I mean? I don't mean like bad smell or like odor, but I'm saying like it's just the aroma on the first, or like the second set of 5 that we just played right now. Leading, of course, track 12 is gonna be included into that, but I feel like the middle of the pack is really where the strength of this mixtape is located at, man. It's just fire, bro. Fire, fire, fire. With that being said, I'll see y'all in part 3. Whoop!